Heavenly Father, we come to you tonight with open hearts and minds, excited to receive whatever it is that you want to speak to us, Lord. And as we practice working with each other and listening to each other's stories, we pray the grace of your Holy Spirit that you would be with us and that you would be our teacher in the midst of all of it. Bless this time together, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So I have everybody muted. So if you need to talk, you're going to have to unmute yourselves. Okay. And I'm going to switch my view here. And just a reminder that if at any time you want to just have someone's face on the screen, that you can pin that person or that, you know, the main GSM room. Right now, there's nobody in the room except me. So unless Elsa Jane comes, it'll just be me with you tonight. So I want to, I guess some of us were talking about there have been a couple of significant deaths in the ministry here recently. Just this week, we had Bruce O'Neill, who he and his wife Eileen have been huge supporters of Good Samaritan Ministries for, I think, about as long as it's existed, that Bruce passed away of a heart attack this week. And they own the U.S. basketball camp. And in 2002, they actually hosted our international conference. And so we had all of our leaders from around the world here in 2002. And we did a retreat at the U.S. basketball camp that they hosted. And so anyway, Bruce is a very significant loss to the memory, but to the ministry. But we also just ask that you support his wife in prayer, Eileen. They have really poured themselves out for the ministry through the years. And Eileen's a nurse. They live down in the Eugene, Springfield area. And in 1996, I think it was, my son was diagnosed with severe adolescent, early adolescent onset scoliosis, to where his spine in less than a year went from no curve in it to like a 70 degree curve, and his organs were being impinged, and it was pretty dramatic. And Eileen was a significant resource when we sought help with Sam, with our son, and he ended up having surgery there in Eugene. And I mean, it was just like miraculous, but Eileen was one of those that was there by our side during all of that and has been by the side of a lot of people through the years. So Eileen, and then we have another close member in the ministry who has been here longer than me, I know, and I've been here since 1991. And her ex-husband killed himself this week. And so, you know, anytime there's suicide, it's complicated. There's always a trail of what ifs and if onlys and I should have and they shouldn't have. And, you know, just all of those messy questions, unfinished things that are left when somebody dies by suicide. But they have two daughters. And then, so, of course, pray for the daughters as well as her. I mean, he was an ex, but she never remarried. So anyway, some significant loss. And it seems like every time I turn around, I hear of somebody else who has cancer. One of our board members who went off the board just this year has been diagnosed with stage 4 cancer, liver cancer. So hold the world in prayer. it's hard times. And especially in these times when we can't go and visit people and see them like we would normally, and hold memorial services and big gatherings. And we have Thanksgiving coming up and Christmas, and that's a tough time when you have significant loss in the holidays. So tonight we're going to continue. I'm going to teach briefly some life history stuff. I didn't get to hear all of what Teresa taught. I heard part of it. So if I'm redundant with any of it, you'll get to hear it twice. And if not, you'll get to hear something new too. Because all of us have our unique perspectives of doing this. And so I want to encourage you that you're going to have trouble getting it wrong. Okay. I love one of the rules that Peter Levine has in the trauma training that I go to. He says, you, in every session, you must make at least 3 mistakes or you're not learning. So go for it and be glad to make mistakes. Because what we're going to do here in a while is I'm going to put you into breakout rooms. And some of you have experienced that and some of you have not. But you'll find yourself assigned to a breakout room, and I'm going to put 3 people in each room. And so in each room, there's going to be one person who's practicing doing a life history. So hopefully you have a life history form, or you can just take a sheet of paper and draw the lines on it for the years. So one person will be the client, one person will be the client. Counselor, and then the third person will be an observer and an intercessor, okay? And so when you're in these breakout rooms, we're going to spend about 20 minutes with one person counseling the other and the third person observing and interceding. And it's going to be very simple rules. It'll be, you can stop at any time. You know, if the counselor feels stuck, you can stop and say, time out, can you help me? And so the third person observer can maybe help, or, you know, because this is just practice. And like I say, you really can't get it wrong. You're just practicing listening to each other's stories. And I've found when I've done this in the group room live that people pair up and they begin practicing and it's hard to get them to stop. And very seldom do I even have anybody
speaker off.
Sorry, I just knocked the speaker off the podium and unplugged it. Can you hear me now? Okay.
Yes.
Okay. So anyway, we're going to practice for about 20 minutes. Then I'll bring you back into the main room and we're going to debrief. And then we'll go back again for 20 minutes and the next person will counsel. So hopefully we'll have time to do 3 rounds of this tonight so that each person will get about 20 minutes of practice and some time of debrief. So say from 6:30 to 7, we'll do a 20-minute practice and a 10-minute brief debrief. 7 to 7:30, the same thing, 7:30 to 8. And then we'll spend the rest of the time discussing what we experienced, okay?
Cindy, what does the third person do?
The third person is just an observer.
Okay.
An observer and an intercessor to be praying.
Okay.
And as the observer, if the counselor gets stuck, they can always stop and you can have a discussion about where you might go next with it, okay? Excuse me, just a minute. Okay, and I might go over a little bit more with you right before you start. But a few of the things that I wanted to share with you about case histories or life histories. Life histories are a lot about perspective and helping the client gain perspective in their life. And I'm gonna share the screen and draw this funky little image that to maybe help you understand what I'm talking about. And so when I talk about perspectives, I like to use the example of maybe a city on the hill. And I lived for 35 years in Pendleton, Oregon, which is on hills. There's a North Hill, South Hill, a Southeast Hill. And so I like to explain, okay, if I had four people come to town and they're all blindfolded and they've never seen Pendleton, I'm gonna send somebody over to one hill. For some reason, thought of mine. And so this is my primitive picture of a couple of hills and here's a valley down in between. And so I send somebody to go stand on the North Hill and somebody to go stand on the South Hill. And then somebody else over here on the Southeast Hill. My drawing tool isn't working very well. That's a person, okay, in case you can't tell. And Pendleton's down here. So I'm gonna have them each draw a picture of what they see. And then when they come back together, they're gonna take their blindfolds off and they're gonna show each other their pictures. And one will say, oh, well, here's what Pendleton looks like. That's what this one over here is gonna say. It looks like this. And this one over here saying, no, it looks like this. And this one over here saying, this is what Pendleton looks like. And so they're all standing on the same, on different hills looking at the same thing. And so they have different perspectives of the same thing. They're all Pendleton, but they all look different. And it's kind of like, it's interesting, I have a book called Eyewitness, and it talks about how eyewitnesses are the worst kind of testimony that there is. That let's say you have a vehicle accident at an intersection and there's somebody on each one of those corners. And if the police go and they interview each person that saw that wreck, and they also interview the people in the cars that were in the wreck, they're going to have about six different stories of what happened. And they may all have pieces of the same thing, but each person is going to interpret what happened according to their perspective. And so as an individual, we can say that this hill represents their life history. All of their experience is what creates this perspective. And so, of course, the older you are, the bigger your hill is. Let's say if you've got a three-year-old, their little hill's down here. Because that's all of life that they have to compare to. And so they look at this and they see this down here. They don't see this stuff up here, either that or it's way distorted because they're looking up at it. And so we can also use this to say, this would be an example of an event in our life. And so I have this event down here in the valley that happened in my life. And because I'm 3 years old, this is what it looks like. That's what I experienced. Because all I have to compare to is what happens in my home or what has happened to me in those three short years. But my mother's standing on this hill and she looks at that experience and says, No, it didn't happen like that. And she's interpreting this story from her perspective. And then there's someone else on the other hill, and they have a whole different perspective because of their history and because of their experience. And I always think it's funny when I get together with my brother and we tell stories, because his stories, it's like, he tells a story and I'm like, wait a minute, I was there and it wasn't like that. Because even though we grew up in the same family with the same parents, just the fact that he was a boy and I was a girl gave us a different experience on this history. So we each had our own history looking at the same experience, and we had different stories. And so whenever we're doing life histories, part of what we're doing is that the person begins to gain new perspective, because a lot of times that's what messes us up, is we have this perspective and it doesn't line up with the perspective of those around us. And so we begin to look at our own life, and then we begin to look at the life of the other people that were involved with us. And we begin gaining new perspective on them. And I call, you know, it's sometimes like walking over to their hill, standing on their hill and going, I wonder what it looked like to them. But then overall, what fits in with what Elsa Jane was teaching about human history and spiritual history is that God is the only one that has the real perspective. He's the only one that holds the truth. And so as we're listening to the stories of this person's life, we're asking questions that help them gain three different perspectives: their own life, the life of others, and then what does God see? What's his perspective? And often it's gaining insight into the truth, into this God's perspective, and then seeing the humanity of the other people that are involved in our stories that gives us the ability to forgive, to let go, to step back and be able to hand that experience over to the Lord and say, you are the only just judge. This person, this situation, or whatever is in your hands. And what's beautiful about doing this style of history where you're doing it on a timeline, it turns out kind of like a picture. And you can see that if you look in The Need for Understanding. And Frida did a great job of typing all of that in that history. But you're going to have a handwritten history, so it's not going to be quite as neat and clean. But you're going to be able to look at that and have kind of a snapshot of somebody's life, that they begin putting the pieces together and getting a linear picture of what happened in their lives. Because often we've got a fragmented history a lot of times. And I always start over here with the birth. And I know Teresa went into that quite a bit and let you see how important it can be, just the number of questions you can ask around somebody's birth. And as I do the life histories, you know, this is going to be 5 years here and 10 here at the end. Whoops. and 20 and 30, that I always kind of write on a diagonal. And I know Elsa Jane mentioned last week that you don't necessarily start here and just go all the way through, that you may start here and have them tell a story of that. And then you may jump down over here, because when they start telling this, it reminds them of something that happened here. And so you may jump around, but the key is you're beginning to put things in order on this timeline. And one of the really important things about this is that you always want to use the language of the client. If they say something was upsetting, you're not going to put on their they were angry. Because if they use the word upsetting, you're going to put upset. You're going to use their words and their language. And the main reason for this is that it helps you remain objective. And so you don't start interpreting what they're saying. You put their words on this timeline. And I typically will tell a person that I'm never going to write anything on here that you can't see. And at some point, I will typically hand, you know, once we've gotten quite a few things on here and got it kind of filled out, I may hand that timeline to them and say, what do you see? And it's always fascinating at what people see, because they usually see things that I didn't see. And they'll make connections that they've never had before. So it's very, very important. Down here on this bottom line, we have a place for like siblings. And so you're going to start with the oldest sibling here, and you'll put that sibling's name. And then how much time was there between your oldest sibling and the next sibling? Say there was 3 years, and I'll usually put a 3 there. And so the next sibling was the client. So I'm going to put me. That's supposed to say me. Sorry, my stylus doesn't work too good here. Whoops, where did it go? For some reason, my picture just disappeared. There it is. Sorry about that. So anyway, and if there's 6 kids, you're going to, oh, I still got the eraser on. Whoops, I keep erasing. I don't know how to undo my eraser now. I'm going to just clear the whole thing. And, but let's say you're doing this. All right. I didn't practice enough here. I can't get it to draw again now. And so you're doing the children's timeline. That you're going to put each child, and you will put their name above that line. And how long it was. Of course, it's not going to let me draw what I want. Anyway, so the number of years that is between each of them. And a lot of times when I'm asking about siblings, I'll ask are you close to any of your siblings? And let them just share a little bit about their relationship with each one of them. So So I'm going to stop there for a minute. Do you have any questions about what I've been sharing so far, or observations, either way?
I got one question. You know, how long, I know, how long do you take to do a history? I mean,
I keep the history page open as long as I have the client.
It's right. At the beginning, when you first start, before you start doing, you know, a plan, figure out what you're going to do, how long would you spend?
Typically 2 or 3 sessions that you'll work on that history. It depends on why, you know, what their presenting problem is. Why did they come in? What are they looking for? But especially if I'm working with someone who has a significant trauma history, I want to make sure I get to know them well, you know, and so I'm going to want a pretty thorough history before I dive into the specifics. But it's fascinating how often just doing the history brings some healing. And there's times, though, when you'll be doing this history and you're really working on just staying with the facts, but your client will get triggered or hijacked into something, and you're going to have to go there for a little bit. You're going to have to do something to help them process as much as they need to in the moment and be able to stabilize before they finish the session. That's a lot. We work a lot on that kind of stuff in the level 2-3 training. Thanks, Rich. Any other questions?
So in the first session, say you have an hour to meet with the client, and they come in. I would think maybe you chat with them for about 10 to 15 minutes, and maybe within that time, you have some ideas. Could one start the timeline on that first session?
Yes, absolutely. I start it sometimes while I'm doing the intake, because they'll share some things during an intake that are part of their history. And so even off of the intake form, I can begin to write in some things on their history timeline. So whenever they are sharing, you can put anything that has to do with their history on that timeline, no matter where you're at. But when we do a counseling session, there is a time that I call orientation. It's like when they come into the room and you are just going to chit chat for 5-10 minutes, whatever, just to kind of settle in to decide what direction you're going to go. But it's mostly to help the client be at ease and ready to do the work. And sometimes you'll have people who come in very escalated or very activated. Maybe they've had something that's pretty significant that just happened. And so they come in and they're very emotionally triggered already, and they want to just start dumping out what they're upset about or anxious about or whatever has just happened to them. And so you're going to use that first part of the session to help them, in a sense, come into the room with you, to calm down, to be able to focus and be face to face with you. And that's where I use some grounding exercises with people. And I might just say, okay, let's take a deep breath together. And we might take 2 or 3 deep breaths together, and I'll invite them to just, do you want to just sit back and look around the room a little bit and just let your eyes go where they want to and see what you notice? And so it kind of helps them get out of the activation and to begin to engage with you, because it's more about, you need to make sure that you have a connection with that person before you really start going into the counseling session. Because if they come in and they're so totally focused on their anxiety or fear or anger or whatever it is, you're not going to get very far until they have de-escalated a little bit and can begin and make a connection with you as the counselor. Does that make sense?
Now, do you do that even with your well-established clients or clients on like visit number 5? Do you still take that time, maybe 5 or 10 minutes to
yes.
kind of set an atmosphere?
Yep, that is something I do with every session. And after you've done that for a while, your client gets used to it and they will come in expecting it. They'll come in expecting to have you help them calm down and engage with you before you begin a session. And that's just, like I say, it can be meaningless chit chat that starts that, and that's okay. Other questions?
I have a question.
Okay.
Regarding our assignments, as we're doing these life histories, case studies, are we able to submit this as part of our work? Or if we've started case studies with others, how does this and other work we've done pertain to our assignments?
Well, typically in class, you're only going to be doing like 20 minutes with a person. And so you can meet with, you can agree to get together with that person and complete that history with them, because you probably need to spend an hour getting, at least getting some kind of a baseline for practice, okay? And so meeting up with other classmates to do histories is a great idea. So you may start it during a session here and then get hold of them and say, hey, can we follow up on that? Do you want to do each other's histories? You know?
Thank you.
I have a question.
Uh-huh.
So you would spend more than an hour though for each case history, life history, correct?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, you're probably, like I say, I've got that history form in front of me as many years as I'm counseling somebody. It's always shocking how sometimes things come out after you think you really know this person, you've been with them a long time. One example for me was, I was counseling a woman who, she had, I'm trying to remember what her presenting problem was. And I'd been counseling her for at least several months, done quite extensive life history. And I had this really strange vision in my head while I'm counseling her. And it's like, I saw a picture of somebody like they were, you know, like an Eskimo, somebody that lived up at the North Pole, and they had the big parka and the furry hat and everything. And I thought, well, that's kind of odd. And I said, now this may sound strange, but I'm going to ask you, does this mean anything to you? And so I told her about what I had seen. She goes, oh, I lived in Alaska for X number of years, and it was something like 12 miscarriages she had never mentioned. You know, so always keep the case history open.
Yeah.
And sometimes too, I tell people, never force memories. Do not go hunting or digging up memories or trying to get somebody to remember something. Leave that to the Holy Spirit. I believe that He brings us to a memory when we're ready for it and when we're in a safe place. Because one of the things you're doing during this history time is you are creating safety for this person. I don't think you can land on the face of this earth for more than a few days without experiencing some kind of trauma in your life. So every client that walks through your door, or you see on the street or at church or wherever you're ministering, they have experienced something traumatic in their lives. And sometimes God gives us a protective gift where we don't remember what happened. Our bodies remember, our bodies react, but we may not attach those reactions to the original memory. And that's okay. Don't wake that up before it's time. Because when trauma happens, it is traumatic because we don't have any control over what happened. The less control we have, the more likely we are to be traumatized. Because it registers in our primitive brain, that part of our brain that all animals have. You know, I'd had a significant, it was kind of an epiphany, I think. I don't know, maybe you've all had it already, but I was working with somebody and we were talking about animals, and her kitty was diagnosed with cancer. And the discussion that we got into was that animals do not fear death. They don't have the cognitive processor that we do. Animals just live. They just live until they die. They have that primitive automatic fight or flight response in them that is a survival response, but it's not because they fear dying. It's because God has designed their brains to go into a survival mode to protect them. And that we as human beings do the same thing. We get triggered into that survival response, only unlike the animals, we don't complete the response and we get stuck in it. Animals, especially in the wild, will complete the trauma response and they'll come out of it and go back to grazing after a lion just took them down. As human beings, we get hypervigilant, and there's a whole lot about that you'll learn as we go more into trauma in the next phase. So anyway, be gentle, be slow. And sometimes you will need to help the person slow down. You're going to work with some people who, it's kind of like automatic. You ask a question and it just opens the floodgates and it's like they can't stop talking. And maybe you are the first person that's ever asked them anything about their life. Or maybe they can't stop talking because they're afraid to. If I stop talking, I'm going to have to feel this. I'm going to have to experience it. I'm going to have to really look at it. So you practice, that's part of what you'll do here, is you'll practice. With some people, you'll need to practice slowing down. And that might look like saying, okay, you're getting ahead of me here. Let's just back up a little bit. You said that when you were in grade school, you had a teacher that was very mean or cruel. Let's go back there for just a minute. What happened next? You know, so you may slow them down, or if you see them jumping from kindergarten to age 20 and then back to sixth grade, and then, you know, you may say, let's kind of go back and just stay with your elementary education for just a little bit and help them slow down. And you might even say, so I want you to say your words carefully and listen to your words come out of your mouth and back into your own ear. And you begin listening to your voice, to your tone, to the words that you're using. And it's mind-boggling how healing just that can be. But what you're helping people not be afraid of the feelings that they're having. Because that's what often spirals us into anxiety, is that we're afraid of what we're feeling. And then that fear just makes it worse. And so we get into an anxiety spiral. We're afraid of the fear. And we get more and more anxious. But if we can help people slow down, just start noticing what their body's doing, what their heart rate's doing, what their breathing is doing. And so if you see somebody getting really escalated, really emotional, you can ask them to, hey, let's slow down and just take a few deep breaths right now. Look around the room. Stomp your feet, stand up, do something that helps them get in touch with their body again. Any other questions or comments right now?
I have a question
about the assignment when we were doing, not for today, but for the assignment. I was wondering, so if you're interviewing someone, do we need to do their entire life? Or, because I'm thinking that it's going to be hard to find someone that's, you know, not going to be like a 4-hour, 8-hour thing.
No, you just do a piece of it.
Okay. So like the first like 20 yeah. years or something.
Yeah, you can, and you can just agree on what you want to do, or you just do what you can in 20 minutes.
Okay.
Yeah. So you're not out to see if you can get everything down.
Okay.
In a 20 minute.
So what about when we're working for our assignment outside of class?
It's the same.
Oh, it's the same. Okay. I just wanted to clarify. Okay. Thank you.
Sure.
So when we do our assignments, should we use the intake session notes?
No.
No.
If you go to A Need for Understanding, there's a section in there where Betty has listed a whole bunch of possible questions.
Right.
Just look that, you can cheat for a while. Look at the cheat sheet and see what your heart or mind is led to. Because like I say, this is practice. We're all practicing, okay?
Okay.
So open up that page to where Betty has the questions and refer to it if you feel like you get stuck.
That's page 38. And 39 with the questions.
Thank you.
For understanding.
Okay, so does everybody have some paper at least, or maybe even one of the life history forms in front of you?
Yes.
And so I'm gonna put you in breakout rooms, and I haven't pre-assigned these, so it'll be a surprise to everybody. Whoever you end up with, that's who you end up with. And once you get in that breakout room, then you decide who's going to be the client, who is going to be the counselor, and who's going to be the intercessor. And you'll need to decide that quickly, okay? Because if you sit around, well, I don't care, I don't mind, I'll do it, I don't, no. Just decide.
Because are we gonna get a chance to swap roles? Like, so are we gonna change, okay.
Yeah, we're going to do it for 20 minutes, and then I'll bring you back into this room, and you can debrief all of us with each other. Hopefully we can keep that to about 10 minutes, and then we'll do a couple more breakout rooms. So each time I want you to switch roles, and hopefully it will put you in the same breakout rooms every time. I'm not sure yet. This is a new thing here with me. We'll see how it works, because I want everybody to get some practice.
So, not to point out the obvious, but there's two of us in Shadell Hooper's screen.
Uh-huh. So
when we break out in the breakout rooms, there'll only be three people total, right?
Let's see, how many people do we have total here?
That works.
Yeah, you know, I guess my advice is be flexible, whatever works.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Let's do it.
Okay, and so we have 26 people. We'll have 26. Okay, I'm not sure what it's going to do though with me as the host and the other room.
She's going to go and break up. I see another host.
Okay, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to put you in breakout rooms, and you'll get a notice about a minute before you have to close, I think it is. Let me see what it's going to. Oh, 26 divided by. Okay, so I'm creating 8 breakout rooms. There's one room here that has 4 people in it. Irma Sprini.
Cindy.
Okay, I'm going to remove me from this. Move to room 5. Okay, somebody had a question? No? Okay, I'm going to open all of the rooms, and you will automatically go there. After 30 minutes. So breakout rooms will close automatically after 20 minutes, but there'll be a 60 seconds warning before. Actually, we can make that more. I'll give you a couple of minutes of warning before it's time to close, okay? Okay. All right, here we go. We get to practice.
Joy.
And you should get an invitation to join a room. Thank you. Let's see, Veronica. One more. Solange is there. Yes, Solange is there. Not here. Thank you. Okay, so you're starting to come back in. Shoot. Okay.
Oh, time flies, Cindy. It's not enough.
I know it's not enough. It's difficult to stop, isn't it?
I know. Yeah.
Yeah. So I want you to just share at random, what was that like for you? Do you have questions? Did you need help with anything? What was your experience? First, I want to hear from those that were the counselors.
I was a counselor.
Uh-huh.
Notes so messy. This is normal. Like how you say you wrote diagonally and you kind of get it by year. And I'm like, no, none of that's happening really the first time. So it's like, I can see you have to develop a way to be talking and then like take the important notes or get the important points down. That must come with practice.
You know, in the beginning, I took a lot of notes just on a piece of paper, and then I went back and put it in the timeline after the session. I've gotten now so that I can pretty much put it on the timeline, but it does take some practice. And if you need to do that, you just be where you are and do what you need to do, okay?
Yeah. I was a counselor. Is she done?
Yeah, I'm done. Thanks, Carol.
You're done? Okay. I got so much information.
Uh-huh.
And I had, well, like you said, I had to write out a lot of notes. I mean, I don't have room on my little timesheet for everything. And we went through birth and siblings, marriage, kids, grandkids, and I was just kind of blown away by how much she had been through.
What you could find out in 20 minutes, isn't that amazing?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. Another counselor.
Well, I was a counselor and
go ahead.
I love to get to know people, so I think this could be my favorite thing to do.
Okay.
But I definitely want to print off the form because on my piece of paper it's really hard to understand. I mean,
uh-huh.
Would have been easier to use the form, I think, than just plain piece of paper. Mm-hmm. Although, Cindy, I like your idea of like just writing it on paper and then filling in the form later, because it's mm-hmm. so messy, so hard to figure out where to write things.
Yeah, you kind of get your own system down after a while.
Yeah.
Okay, who else?
I gotta say it was super interesting to do, I did Ariana, and super interesting to do somebody that lives in another country and that grew up in another country. So that was fascinating. I also did the form and did all the kind of lines, but some things that I thought might've been unusual ended up being very normal in their society. And so I thought that was really special, and to hear about, and the things that was other families did the same kind of things that she did. And so I thought that was very interesting. And they like traveling and being nomadic four seasons out of the year and things like that. So it was very, very interesting. Thank you so much. I'm so glad she opened up.
Oh, good. Who else was a counselor?
Yeah, I was a counselor.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I asked lots of questions, almost right now, until grandson, life history, when married, and then the brothers and house.
Yeah, almost lots of questions I did. Yeah, it's good. Yeah.
Uh-huh. So good.
Yeah.
Alta?
Yes, I was a counselor also. And I got lots of information about the first child, first sibling of the lady, and went through both about her maternity and about development of son, 0 to 3 months, first months. I got lots of information.
Good.
Thank you.
Well, I interviewed Sarul, and I don't know, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, well, we ended up working backwards, starting with the recent history and then going back over some of her losses, and then ended up, I felt like we needed to end on something positive. So I asked her who were two people that she were strong supports in her life. And
good question. That's great, Karen. Yeah, and I'm glad you shared that. That's a good way to bring closing, you know, when you have that 5-minute warning or 2-minute warning to come back in. And I asking a support question is really a good thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks, Karen, for sharing that.
Yeah.
I was a counselor. This was really fun. It was my first time to ever do this kind of deal. Hannah, who lives in Uganda, I mean, what a blessing it is, and an encouragement I get from talking to somebody about their life that's on the other side of the planet right now, literally. And it is very inspirational for me. I got a lot from it. I don't know how much she got from it, but I got a ton just talking to her. And I really liked having Shadell as having a witness to this event.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of gave me support, even though it sounds weird, but it felt kind of good to have somebody there watching me do this. It made me feel good. I don't know. The whole process was fun.
Yeah, you know, there is something there about the spiritual energy that even if that person doesn't say anything, having their presence there interceding and witnessing is powerful, not only for the counselor, but also for the client.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, also, it was really nice. Susanna sent me some chat questions in the chat to give me ideas of, you know, what to ask and insights. So that was really awesome.
Okay. Do we have anybody else that was a counselor that hasn't shared yet? Okay. So in order to give everybody a chance to play the counselor role, I'm going to go ahead, and it looks like it'll put you back into the same breakout rooms. And so then you will decide who's going to be the counselor this time. And so you'll switch roles again. Okay, are you ready?
Yes, sir.
Okay, here you go, back to your rooms. next point. Okay.
I think everybody's back.
No, we're still missing about 8 people. But their rooms close here, so they don't have a choice in a minute. Okay.
That makes me cry.
Makes you cry, yeah.
No.
So were you a counselor this time, Bola?
No, I'm the client. That's why I am.
That's right? Why you're crying. That's powerful to have somebody listen to you, huh? Okay, yeah. I want to give counselors a chance to share again this time. Who were the counselors?
Well, I was one.
Okay, Deb.
That was pretty interesting. My paper's a freaking mess. I think that I asked really good questions. She was very informative. And it's really, you know, like the other people said in the first breakout session, it's interesting to interview people from a different country. Mm-hmm. And she's from Cameroon, West Africa.
Yeah.
So that was nice. Very smart lady, boy, I tell you that. She's done a lot. Goodness sakes. Lots and lots of schooling and, you know, it was good. Yeah. It was good. I enjoyed it.
Good.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's one of the advantages we have with GSM, especially now that we're doing this Zoom, is that we do get to have opportunity to hear stories from around the world versus just our next door neighbors. So
yeah,
that's pretty cool.
That's very cool. Yep.
Yeah. Okay. Who else was a counselor?
I was. And let me tell you, Zoom is the appropriate word. I just felt like I was firing off one question after another.
And,
I'm used to doing that. So I don't know if I need to slow down, you know, but I just sense that I wanted to hear the whole story is what I wanted. And, but I did feel like I realized I can't judge a person by how they look or how they act because I was really surprised at what I heard. Mm-hmm. And so I realized that I was doing a little bit of judging beforehand, you know, and I was able to, by asking questions, realize that. And I also, I felt like because this person said they, you know, were Christian, I was able to ask specific questions having to do with what they need right now. Can I pray for them to kind of wrap it up, you know, because you can't really in 20 minutes get into any issues, right? Mm-hmm. So to find out what it is that they need was helpful for me.
Okay. Good.
I'd like to hear what they thought, but I think that would be more beneficial than what I thought.
Yeah, that is beneficial. Thank you, Susanna. Okay.
I was a counselor too, to Shadell.
Uh-huh.
And I am really, really blessed to have counseled someone on Zoom that she's in Oregon and I'm in Uganda. So this was a very blessing time whereby she told we went upwards from where she is and we went to the history, the family history and how she was raised and all that kind of stuff. So it is really something that gave an insight into her life, into like what she has gone through, how she was raised and finding out that her purpose, what is her purpose in life. So the questions we did and the interaction we had is something whereby I really don't know what I asked her. It was as if the Holy Spirit was giving me the question to ask her, but it was so revealing and we got time to get to know about what is going on. Yeah.
Fantastic. Thank you, Hannah.
You're welcome. Thank you too for the opportunity.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Okay. Another counselor.
Hi, this is Sarul.
Sarul.
Yeah, so I was counseling Bolor. I would say this is the first time I've ever done counseling, asking these type of questions. So it was interesting. And although it's in a council, but it seems like it was kind of interactive conversation. But I try to ask as many questions as possible to learn about the client. mm-hmm. and try to find out what is the main concern right now, or what is in her heart right now that bothering her, you know, etc. Seems like she's very strong, you know, and a very educated lady. And I try to see what is the weak spot or weak thing that in her life she has witnessed. So it was her dad eventually. So that's what I was looking for, something, and I feel like found the main issue that was in her, deep in her heart. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So yeah. So it was interesting for me. Yeah, I'm not sure how was it for her, but and the observer, but was it fun for me? I mean, to learn more. Yeah, thank you.
Uh-huh, thank you.
I was a counselor.
Mm-hmm. Sabrina.
So Undra gave me the blessing of answering questions and getting to know her tonight. That was something that really, just even as we started, even being the listener, it's such a gift to hear these intimate details, asking people their life stories. And I wanna know her more. It's precious.
Mm-hmm.
And I felt really honored that she would be open to share. I felt it was really precious. And I also learned that in Mongolian culture, the name is drawn by luck. Mm. And I thought that was really interesting.
Yeah.
To know that it's not given by the parents. It's her name was drawn and given by the hospital, and it's part of, she said, part of her culture, part of her life. Yeah.
Yeah, isn't that fun to find out different cultural practices? Yeah.
It's really great. Thank you.
Uh-huh. Thank you, Sabrina.
I was a counselor too.
Okay, Joseph.
Yeah, it was really sobering and very teaching to get to know my client a little bit. It just seems like 20 minutes is such a short time. It goes by so fast. Yeah, because you get one topic and before you know it, you drill down into a lot of other things that are possible. And what I did was, if I found myself, trying to begin to give suggestions of things that should be done, and so, but which I don't think is the right thing to do.
Just but you hurt yourself, didn't you?
That's right.
Yeah.
So it's it was good to get 20 minutes to get to know my client and see how or prove the fact that a timeline lasts for a long time, because it doesn't end. There's just so much information that.
Yes.
Will come out with time and situations that that develop as you talk with the client. But one funny thing was that my client left the office and shut the door on me before I asked him the last question. right, Gabe?
It took me away on its own.
That's right.
I was listening. It took me away.
So it was good to get to know him. And I found out that I did a lot of writing, about 2 pages of taking down the notes, because it seems to me like it's kind of difficult to fill the timeline. Maybe it's the constraint of the time, but I would prefer just writing notes and then filling the timeline with time, so to speak.
Uh huh.
Yeah. But it was a good experience. Very good.
Thank you, very good. Thank you, Joseph.
I was a counselor this last time around.
All right.
And it was really interesting because as we started, I wasn't sure how to ask, like, how old you are, because for us, that's not a question you normally pose to somebody. And so that was, it kind of gave that little, for me, hiccup in the beginning of just like asking that question. Mm-hmm. And it was interesting by just like getting the name and that information. And then we started going like the her beginning of life, I guess you could say, and just how it led into different things. And the person who I was taking their story, it was very easy for her to share things. And so there were times where I had to go back and say, wait, let me ask you about this that she threw out. Because I felt like as I'm trying to be the counselor and put the information on the timeline and keep track of it, but also pay attention, you know, it's just a lot because you want to give them your attention, but you also want to retain the information because you know that you'll be expanding on that. Uh-huh. So I just think that was interesting just to see those dynamics and how they could be at play.
Yeah. Thank you, Veronica. I think we might have one more person.
I was a counselor.
Okay. So
I'm trying to speak in English.
Uh-huh.
That's my English barrier, sorry. So my client was same as like from my country, who is moved from my country to here in America, like mm-hmm. immigrant. So, First, I asked questions. So what you brought today for me by counselor, by me, and then she introduced herself and then also about her son and her son's like family. And her son already married. And then so in this case, I just figure out who's my client. Like that client was bring me the more two people, like son and her daughter-in-law. They have a problem. They have a two twin girl, like and the daughters. So that's why I think it's my clients' issue situations and questions more spreading more.
Uh-huh. I think.
So that's why first I asked about her sons because everybody who's woman like mothers, they so worry about their children, especially son who's married if they have a problem. So we worry about too much into our kids. So my clients, that problem, like, you know, I'm trying, I try to find out that his marriage, that her son's marriage, the daughter-in-law and her son. First asking question like about her son's like, and birth during pregnancy time and then breastfeeding time and also have to growing like, and then that time I find out and when he was like around 2 years, like kindergarten, and then her grandma passed away, mm-hmm. and then her side, like mom's side, and that's why he was with that grandma, and then because she was so busy and working, usually grandma take care of him.
And so also, were you doing the counseling session in English?
Yes, I'm trying.
Okay, yeah, so, that's good practice, because you had somebody, an English speaker in your group. So we have time for the last breakout group, and whoever has not been a counselor will be the counselor this time, okay?
Okay. All right.
And so 20 minutes again, and I will put you back in. I'll put you back in your breakout groups for 20 minutes for the last practice tonight. All right, here we go. Welcome back.
Is your feeling okay?
Uh-huh. Is your feeling good? Yeah, I'm much better.
Hallelujah. So. Okay, I think we're all back. So right now it's quitting time, but I want to give the ones who are counselors a chance to share. And then I am willing to stay on if there's anybody that wants to stay and just share about your experience, either as a client or an observer after that, okay? So let's give the counselors first shot here. So who were the counselors this time?
I was a counselor.
Okay.
And I think I experienced firsthand that I made a lot of notes and I'm going to go back afterwards and write it on the case study, because there was just no ways I could find the proper spot to put it in precisely and keep up with the talk. And I had to slow her down. She was very open with each. I hardly asked a question and it just came out. So I made lots of notes and had to tell her, okay, let's just back up or let's just take a break. And I started with just asking her how her day was, you know, just let's just chit chat a little bit before we dive into the questions. Uh-huh. And I think that was really good. She just opened up and talked about her day, and it was a good day, and why it was good.
Mm-hmm.
I think it went well.
Very good. Very good. I call that self-starters. And then you have people sometimes who you feel like you have to pull every every word out of them. And it's just the differences in our personalities. And
that's right.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, thank you, Irma. Another counselor.
So I was a counselor too, and I think it went really well. It was really, you know, it was a new experience for me to be on, you know, asking the questions and hearing about, you know, another person's life, opening up. Uh-huh. About their life, but I thought it went really well. And I feel like, you know, just listening or just opening up, it's good. It's really good therapy. You know, like, that's what I feel like for my group. Just the aspect of opening up to one another was a really good thing, you know, in terms of therapy. So I think it went really well.
Good. Thank you, Liz.
So I was a counselor.
Gabe.
I was a counselor. My attempt kind of got hijacked and I just turned into an encourager, I think, in this specific situation. But I mean, I found it very interesting that knowing, you know, this week as I've prepared for this class, I've taken, you know, writing down some extra notes on, you know, trying to keep ordered questions and keep a nice, like, control plan for when I do my practical thing. And none of that worked. Or none of all that went out the window as I think Christ hijacked our session a little bit. Uh-huh. And but at the same time, what did happen flowed really well when it was like the right thing was being talked about, and it wasn't because it's what was chosen, it's because of what came out. Mm-hmm. And we just had a really powerful time in the last 20 minutes. So it was really good, but it definitely, when God takes it and God controls it, the best things happen.
Yes. Amen.
Anyway.
Yeah, we can make great plans, but there's no script.
Okay, I want to share. I was a counselor.
Okay, Ariana.
Yeah. And during the Zoom breakout rooms, I was praying a lot, asking for God to lead. But I was a little bit worried before I start. But after we start, there is no worries. And actually, we start the right point. It was so amazing. And I blessed from her a lot, and it was wonderful talking. Even the 20 minutes, we all shared lots of things, and it was very nice. I really appreciate she opened her heart for me. It was so nice. Thank you.
Uh-huh. Thank you, Ariana.
I hope God, Holy Spirit leading me well. Leading yeah. me, actually, he's always will, but this time is so nice.
Sounds like that happened.
I was a counselor this time around.
Okay.
I think I get in my head a lot. And so the fact that there was someone watching and then somebody you're counseling, like I tried to ask questions where I wasn't trying to pry for, like, look for a memory or force a memory on them, but I was also trying to stay the course.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's a little bit hard.
Yeah.
But then eventually it just started flowing. So I feel like the Holy Spirit kind of took over when I was getting in my head.
Yeah, that's
and great. It was really cool to hear Hannah and Rich's stories. So or for all of us to be like vulnerable and talking about those things, and also seeing a perspective from each like the counselor's view and the watcher's view, and the view of the person sharing, you get to see like the whole situation. And so it's good. It was good practice for me anyways. I enjoyed it.
Very good. Very good. Yeah, it's just interesting how when you're in that group, at first you can be self-conscious, but then it's kind of like everything falls away and you just are there with the person. And actually find the other people to be a support in what you're doing. So that's awesome. Thank you, Shadell.
Hi. I was a counselor this time, and for me, it's so amazing time. I have a, such a wonderful two God's daughters, for, and for me, it's, I'm learning from my client, you know. And she just you know, I'm in this morning. I'm asking for God something. And he definitely answers by the, my client today. But I'm so appreciated for, and I'm so encouraged today, because even we are so far away from each other, but God will always work together. And I'm just Romans 8:28, for all things works together. And I'm so appreciated for this time. Thank you, Dan, Dan and Susanna. Thank you.
Thank you, Solange.
And this is Bolor. This was first time, you know, the, being a counselor and asking a life history question. I never imagined. But, you know, the, I talked to a really beautiful lady, then she opened up, you know, her heart. Then I just first asked icebreak question. How did you involve Good Samaritan? Then just backward everything. Then finally she told me childhood trauma. Then just I found out what's wrong. Then it's really good conversation. And, because of the, my client, I have no experience. Then my client, you know, helped me actually. Then finally I figured out everything. But I looked at the, my paper bag, then my timeline messed up. Probably I need to figure out now. Then otherwise everything was good. Thank to God.
Great.
Yeah, I was I was talking to Karen. And Sarol also helped me. Then it was a really nice group.
Very good. Thank you, Bola.
Thank you.
Anybody, other counselors that haven't shared yet?
Other counselors.
Okay, Daniel.
It was the first time for me this time around. And then, my gosh, when I first asked the person, actually, I didn't know where I had to go. So, I mean, I didn't know what questions to ask or anything like that. And I knew nothing. And I wrote down some notes and all that sort of thing. But I didn't know where to go on this one. I also had to work with the language barrier thing. That's kind of difficult. That was a little bit difficult for me. And I'm sorry if I actually I just had difficulty with that, and no harm no foul there, but it was a quite an interesting experience first time around.
And Daniel, let's, you know, whatever you experienced, it is good. You know, that just even it's out of our comfort zone to put ourselves, especially with somebody of another culture and language. And, you know, the thing is everybody here is loving and accepting and kind and willing to help each other. So thank you for just being brave and stepping out there and taking a chance.
Well, thank you.
Good work, Daniel. Thanks.
Thank you. Thanks, everybody.
Okay. Is that all of the counselors? If so, I just open it up to anybody that wants, if you want to share from your experience, and if you need to leave, that's fine too. I just want to give people opportunity to share more fully if you want to about your experience with each other.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
For our assignments, we're going to hand in a piece of paper with the timeline.
Uh-huh.
Right.
Yeah.
Will we hand in extra notes also that we,
you know, you know, you don't really need to hand in the extra notes. What I would rather hear from you is, what was it like for you? What was your experience in doing it? You know, I really don't need to know the details of the history of the person. Okay. What I would like to hear is, what was it like for you? And what questions do you have? What did you learn? What would you do different, maybe? Mm. What did you do well? Mm. Those are the type of things that I like to hear when you turn in your life histories.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
So Cindy, could I just make a comment?
Uh-huh.
So I just wanted to say that for me, I kind of felt more connected to my teammates tonight than, you know, it's always just been a class,
yeah,
with classmates. But for me tonight, I felt connected to the people. I, you know, like it was more, I felt a connection to my teammates. So it wasn't just, you know, we're in the same class, we're just, you know, yeah, taking this together, but I felt like, you know, I related and I could connect more. So this was a really good experience for me, and I'm really thankful. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Me too. Yeah.
You know, and I'm gonna work at trying to put some time in for breakout rooms in all of our classes. And it might be a breakout room where there's half of you, you know, where there's six or eight of you in a room, but figuring out different things like that so that you can connect more one-on-one with each other. So I appreciate you sharing that, Liz.
Cindy, are we supposed to turn in something for tonight, what we did?
What I would like to hear from you tonight is I really would like everybody to turn in a journal or your insight of what did you learn, whether it was in the counseling position, the observation position, or the client? What was important to you tonight?
Sorry, I did miss the first classes. How are we turning in assignments? Are we using email? Or?
Yeah. Just, okay. You can email them, and the email address is training@gsmusa.org.
Cindy.
Uh-huh. Veronica.
I have a question. So I was with Ariana.
Uh-huh.
And she had asked if we could talk more, but do you know a way that we can connect with those people that are in another country?
Yeah.
That if, you know, I know you had said that we can do the life stories or spend more time, you know, for our assignments, but how would we do that with the people in other countries?
Well, I can send out an email list of everybody in the class to you. And if anybody doesn't want your email sent to the class, let me know. Okay. And so that way you can contact each other.
Thank you.
What's that site again, Cindy, that you said training@gsmusa.org? Oh, thank you. Well, I thought this was a great class tonight, Cindy. I just loved it, and I think being the counselor and the client is a really interesting role to mm-hmm. to do, to try to find out which, you know, the hot seat and the hot seat.
Yeah.
That was pretty interesting for me, and I really enjoyed that.
Yeah.
No, I didn't ask a lot of the right questions, and I was all over the flipping page. So that's something that I need to work on. But I think it went really well.
And that's what it's about. is what do I need to work on? What do I need to learn?
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, so thank you.
You're welcome. Good.
I agree. I really enjoyed the class tonight and getting to know my classmates and being in the counselor position and getting a feel for what it would be like when we do get clients.
Okay, thank you, Carol.
Okay.
Anybody else want to share? What was it like being the observer? Did you like that part? Getting to watch somebody else?
I did because you kind of could see outside looking in.
Mm-hmm.
And just, you know, sometimes when you're on the hot seat, you don't really recognize some of the things that you're asking, or maybe that might have been a bad question, or maybe you could have gone through a different avenue. You can see that from the observer point of view.
Uh-huh.
So that was good for me because I was the observer first. And so I was able to kind of learn from the counselors that went before me. So that was pretty cool. And I learned a lot too.
Good. Thanks.
Yeah, there's nothing like doing something in practice. You learn by practice, and it's very intimidating. Like for some of us who've never done any counseling before, formally, you know, mm-hmm. you start by saying, hey, what am I going to say? What am I going to do? What am I going to ask? But once it starts flowing, you know, a lot of the information, you get calm down, and it flows very well with the guidance of the spirit too. Even as an observer, I found myself sometimes wanting to chime in. I said, no, I'm not supposed to chime in.
Yeah.
So it was really good. That's good to do that.
I think as the observer, you can see that you have in your mind, oh, I would go this direction or I would ask that question. But you see the counselor go a different direction and it's good, you know, and that neither of them are wrong. They're just different.
Cindy, may I ask one question?
Uh-huh.
I'm sorry, I missed my assignment. I think, what was my assignment and what is the deadline?
Oh, to do a life history of somebody. It can be somebody in the class or it can be a family, friend, whatever, to spend at least an hour with them, or you can do more if you want.
Okay.
And then when you turn that in, I don't necessarily need to see all your notes or anything, but to see your timeline and then to write a brief summary of here's what I learned. This is what I would do different. Just kind of talking about what it was like for you.
What is the deadline?
By the end of the year, by the middle of December, because we're finished up this year, the middle of December.
Uh-huh.
So I'd
thank
like
you so much.
So I'd like each of you to turn in at least one life history before the end of the year.
Uh-huh. Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Cindy?
Yes.
I noticed something after, as we were talking, being the client, waiting to be led.
Ah.
Instead of like spilling my beans, just letting the counselor lead me.
Yeah.
And I don't know if this is unique for myself. I'm going to pray about it.
Mm-hmm.
But it is really interesting as a client to be led.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's really unique for me.
Yeah, nice observation.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah, Sabrina, I totally relate to you, but I wasn't that good. I kind of took over. I admit I took over because I am good at bringing people in and not talking about me. And so I became the counselor, so to speak. It is hard to just not take over anyway. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And these are great things that you begin to see about yourself in these situations. And it's all part of our growth and maturing. So that's great. Thank you for sharing that.
I'll share something. I thought this class was so effective to do all sides like we did, the counselor and the client. And today I was actually in a different realm, was unofficially counseling, but helping someone in a tough situation on about a 2-hour phone call. And I found myself asking the Holy Spirit for guidance and doing the things that you're teaching us in class.
Uh-huh.
And looking forward to class tonight to like hone my skills in. And then I received more back from being the client tonight and with like the Holy Spirit helping me than I ever gave out like today. Like I was already blessed by helping someone else. And then I personally got so much tonight with when I was a client. So it was kind of an amazing day all tied together.
Great. That's great to hear, Jennifer. Thank you.
Yeah. For sharing.
Anybody else before we close?
I think for me as the observer, it was interesting to be there and observe and not want to jump in and like ask more questions. And that was difficult for me. And I know at the end I said, wait, I have one question I want to ask. But I was actually proud of myself because normally I would have just jumped in and tried to get the question that I was looking for answered to expand a little bit more.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that was pretty interesting, you know, just being there and reminding myself, I'm not the counselor nor the client. I'm just supposed to take it in. And so that was really interesting to me, how many times I just wanted to jump in to ask another question to get a different detail, you know?
Yeah, so. Yeah. And that's a great part of the practice and a great part of the observation is learning to just sit back and listen. Yeah.
I agree with you, Veronica, because I actually chose that role the first time because I really didn't want to do that. I thought you could choose a role and we didn't have to do the other roles. And I thought, I don't have to be the counselor because I think I've said before, I don't know why God asked me to take this class. But what really touched me is, like what you said, Cindy, is that it's okay to have a different, you know, come up with different things and because we are different, right? And but what really touched me is hearing from others that they really thought I was already a counselor. That really surprised me, you know? And so anyway.
Great. Thanks.
Hey. I agreed with Veronica. I found myself in that position wanting to know more about a certain thing and wanting to ask questions in a certain direction.
Mm-hmm.
And it made me second. It's like, am I really listening at all? I mean, am I listening? If I was the counselor in that situation, would I be listening to the person or would I be exploring what I wanted to explore? And so it gave me a pause of like, as I thought about all these things, like, oh, I wonder, I would go this way or I wonder this or I wonder that. It's like, how much of that is me not being attentive to the client, actually attentive to where they're at and just wanting my own information from them?
That is an excellent point, Gabe, because one of the things that Betty pounded into us was never ask a question out of curiosity. Let that go in you. Never ask a question in a counseling session out of curiosity, because curiosity is trying to satiate my own desires. Ask the questions that the client needs. So I'm glad you brought that up. It's a very important point. Curiosity is a wonderful thing that God has given us. It's what leads us to learn and to search and to find more and to discover. But in a counseling session, you're trying to help the client develop that. This life history is a discovery tour. You're helping them discover themselves, discover the truth about the Lord. Wonderings. I mean, there may be times that my curiosity fits in with what the Lord wants to ask them, but make sure and check yourself. Why am I asking this question? Is it to help the client? Okay, we're about 9 o'clock, so I think we're gonna say a prayer and close for the evening, okay? Who would like to say our closing prayer tonight?
I would. This is AJ Bustamante.
All right, AJ, we haven't got to hear from you tonight, so great.
Oh, you are lucky, trust me. I have too much to say sometimes. Okay, all right, you guys. So, Heavenly Father, we're grateful. We're grateful and thankful that you could bring us all here today so that we can connect with everyone in the group, so that we can connect with these people we're training to help, so that we can connect with you. And we give thanks for that. We just want to pray that we take this message into our hearts so that we can use it in our everyday lives to make ourselves better than those around us and be that shining example that we know that you're calling us to be. And so we just want to continue to uplift each other as we move forward together, and help us to stay safe from coronavirus as well. Mm-hmm. And pray for these things in your name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. And amen. Amen.